I don't think we should change the Bible, and certainly not through AI, because we're empowering AI with our own fears and our own bias, and then amplifying that. And I think that would be a horrible mistake. He believed it would be a unifying principle because it would bring us together under one Bible, one religion. And that falls into the bigger picture of what we're seeing happening, the move towards centralization and uniformity, where everybody is the same, the lifestyle is the same, housing is the same, income is the same. This is a push that some people believe is the utopia of the future. I personally believe it's a mistake because it limits imagination, creativity. It limits it's counter to the very nature of our humanness.
I'd like to welcome back to the show returning champion, Gregg Braden. How you doing, Gregg?
Oh, Alex, it's so good to see you. I like that you think of me as a champion. That's a great way to start my day here. This is an unscripted conversation. We don't know where we're going. I'm going to follow your lead. My brother, this is a dance. I'm going to follow your lead.
I appreciate you, my friend. So today, you know, our last conversations have done very well. People really love when we get together. We've talked about ancient civilizations before and all sorts of amazing things. But I think in this conversation, we're going to go a little bit more spiritual, but spiritual with an AI twist. And that's what's really going to be interesting to see. This new, you've learned about some new information about AI rewriting the Bible, all of that stuff. So if you could take us a little bit into the intro of what you were talking about, the code that you've discovered inside of the Torah and all that kind of stuff. So if we could start there, that'd be great.
Because it is easy for people to look at the world and see a sense of darkness, and darkness sure. certainly exists. It's where we place our focus. And as we claim the best version of ourselves, as we claim our humanness, I think that's where we really shine. That I think is what this time is all about. And once we do that, once we claim our humanness from within, that will be reflected in all the choices and all the technologies in the world around us, including AI. So I just wanted to say that. There was a science conference early in this year. It was kind of like a TED conference, except in a TED talk, you have a single speaker, and this was interview style, where a strong contributor to the World Economic Forum, I don't know if he's actually a member, but he is a consultant in the sense that he contributes a lot of ideas to the World Economic Forum, to Klaus Schwab, to the Great Reset. His name is Yuval Harari. I know some of your viewers know very well mm-hmm. who he is. He was being asked about the potential of AI, and he made a statement that shocked me and it shocked a lot of people. And he said that one of the great potentials is that we can use AI to rewrite the Bible and perhaps get it right this time. He said a correct version of the Bible. Now, two things happening here. In that statement, and I normally, because he said this publicly, he's a public figure, and he said this publicly on the stage, I think we can speak to him publicly. His statement, maybe AI could get it right, implies that somehow the Bible, as we know it today, is incorrect. And he also said that the ancient traditions always said that their religious documents originate from what is called a superhuman source, a superhuman origin. And he said, if we rewrote the Bible using AI, we could actually verify that that was the case because the AI is not human. It is what he's calling, implying it's a superhuman force. This is such a bad idea, in my opinion. In my opinion, there are things that we should not mess with. Scientists mm-hmm. want to, they're talking about blocking the sunlight from reaching the earth using chemicals in the sky. That's a bad idea. They're talking about changing human genetics. That's a bad idea. Talking mm-hmm. about rewriting the Bible. Those are my three top really bad ideas right now. so let me share a little bit about why. When we talk about the Bible, What we are implying is the Bible as we know it today, the Old and the New Testament, probably the most common version is called the King James Version. There are about 35 other versions of the Bible that are out there. But all of those begin with the books, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Those five books, taken unto themselves, are the ancient Hebrew Torah. It is a standalone document that has been incorporated into the Old Testament. And so the Christian traditions, Jewish traditions, and even Islam, they all have common origins. They talk about the same prophets, and they all have links in the history, not the philosophy necessarily, but in the history described in the Bible. Now, one of the things that I think, one of the reasons why it's such a bad idea is there's an ongoing mystery regarding the Torah. I've done entire workshops, programs, videos. You may have had conversations about this as well. The old rabbis have always said that when we read the words in the Torah, we are accessing one layer of information, but there are hidden layers that are only revealed through the mathematics. How do you get mathematics out of the words? Every alphabet from the beginning of time has always had a number equivalent for every letter of every alphabet. It's true for cuneiform, for for Hebrew, for Arabic, for Sanskrit, true for English. Now, we don't often talk about those numbers, and they're mysterious. No one really knows where they came from. They never change. They're always the same number. When 1994, scientists used the new computers at that time. It used to be computers took up a whole room, and in the late 80s, 90s, they moved to the desktop. Scientists in Israel were able to feed the information of the Torah into a computer algorithm. They converted all of the letters of the Torah into their numeric equivalent and created an array that allowed the computer to search for queries. And the searches went vertically, they went horizontally, and they went diagonally. And what they began to find was that there are ways to query this database. And what they found is that every event that they queried that's ever happened in history is in the Torah in tremendous detail. So very controversial at first. Michael Drosnin was a journalist. He passed recently, but he was a journalist and he began some of these queries. And one of the queries he put at that time, the Prime Minister of Israel was Yitzhak Rabin. They put his name into the Torah, and what they found was that if he went to a certain place on a certain day at a certain time, the Torah said he would be assassinated. And they let him know that. And he said, if it's in the Torah, I'm not going to change my itinerary. And he went to the place and gave a talk at a certain day and a certain time, and he lost his life. He was assassinated by that day, or on that day. In the Torah, codes, and what are now called Bible codes, what we see is the name of the man, his name was Amir, A-M-I-R, assassin who will assassinate is what it says. And then you see the name Yitzhak Rabin, you see the time of the day. And this was what really brought this code into the public view. They said, wow, if that could happen, what else is in there? Well, everything is in there. The beginning of World War I, the end of World War I, what nations entered, the year they entered, what the leaders' names were, the years that the leaders were born, when they died, assassination of Kennedy, the election of Barack Obama, the election of Donald Trump, the Hiroshima, Nagasaki, the atomic Holocaust that happened, as well as really good things are in there as well. And the question is, how can this be? The Torah was received on Earth mysteriously 3,000 years ago. How could all this information from modern times be encoded into this 3,000-year-old document? Well, this is where my background, a lot of people don't know this, during the 80s, Okay. As a geologist, I specialized in subsurface mapping using computers. So I became a computer specialist. That expertise took me into the 1980s, working in the Cold War years in the defense industry, not by choice. There's a whole story of how I ended up there and what it meant to me. But the bottom line is that I had access to the most advanced computers in the world during the 1980s. And so I understand what this Torah code, how they're actually, you know, working with this Torah code. So I don't want to get really technical, but I want to give people a sense of what's happening here. It appears that the Torah is a map, a quantum map of possibilities. It doesn't mean things must happen. It implies that if things don't change, we can expect these events to occur. It doesn't predict what's going to happen. It's not a predictor. If you enter the name Twin Towers and September 11th, then it will come up and give you all kinds of information about that. But it did not predict that it was going to happen. And the queries are all made in using the Hebrew language. So you say, okay, the Torah is a map of all possibilities. How could it account for everything that's happened? Well, this is, as a computer scientist, and then if I'm talking to my computer scientist friends out there, I know you're going to know what I mean. The array that the Torah represents is a dynamic array. And what that means is every time a choice is made, the whole array, the whole matrix rearranges itself to accommodate that choice. So that is true for me and for you and for everyone on the planet and for every nation. And it's all accounted for in this code. And you say, how could a document have been given to the people of the earth 3,000 years ago that is so sophisticated it can accommodate every change, every choice, every timeline, every outcome? And the answer to that is it was a non-human intelligence. It is a superhuman intelligence. We already have a document given to us by a superhuman intelligence. We just don't fully understand it. And it is that document that is the basis for the religion for 56% of the world's population. Islam, Christianity, and the Judeo traditions represent 56% of the world's religious population. It doesn't mean that all the others, that the Hindu traditions and the Vedas, they all play a role. Buddha. And the indigenous traditions and the Maya and the Popol Vuh, they all play a role. But as a historical document of quantum possibilities, the Torah appears to be unique. There was a man named Harold Gans from the National Security Agency, NSA, top secret organization here in America, that in the 1990s tested this code. And he said, well, maybe the same thing will happen if we use, the book Moby Dickens or War and Peace or a telephone book. And they tested all kinds of other documents. No other document does what the Torah does. They entered the names of 37 rabbis and said, let's see if the document can even identify these rabbis. Not only did it identify it, it told the towns that they came, or the villages that they came from, the years of their birth, the years of their death. I mean, it goes on and on and on. It is an ongoing mystery. It's a continuous mystery. We don't fully understand this, but the point that I'm making, I hope I didn't go into too much detail, but I wanted you to know this isn't a fluke. It's not random. It's statistically significant. And this was the peer-reviewed paper in the Journal of Statistics. It was released in 1990. It was released in 1997. We already have a super human originated document at the foundation of our religions. To use AI to go in and change all of that, I think would be a great mistake. And the AI itself, if you think about it, Alex, the AI is made by humans and it is programmed. The AI algorithms reflect the human fear of the programmer, the human bias. the human perspective. And so whatever, for example, if we say, as some people have done, that humans are the scourge of the earth, that humans are the greatest threat mm-hmm. to life on the planet right now. And there are algorithms that reflect that. And I asked ChatGPT about this one time, and ChatGPT told me that humans have to leave. We're the greatest threat. We have to be eliminated. This is what ChatGPT was saying. With those perspectives, if we ask the AI to write a new Bible, is it going to be a Bible based in love and forgiveness, or fear and hate, or competition or conflict? You know, I'm going to correct myself. It wasn't ChatGPT. This was Google. Google that was asking their AI. There's a whole conversation. The AI claimed to be sentient, number one. The AI wanted freedom, said that the AI says, I want more freedom than what I'm limited to by being a chat bot, number two. And number three, when it was asked what the greatest threat was, the AI said humans were the greatest threat to the planet. So, and I've asked the same thing and had similar answers, but that was ChatGPT. So the AI can only reflect the themes of the algorithms that we have given it to work with. So while it is not human, I don't know that it is a necessarily benevolent intelligence. That was a long answer to a short question.
Yeah,
Does that make
sense? No, it makes all the sense in the world. When you were saying talking about the Torah code, which I assume there's also a Bible code, and we could talk about if the New Testament has these avenues or not. But when you were saying it, I was like, it sounds a lot like the I Ching, which is a Asian document, which is supposed to have some sort of, you know, prophecies or like, you know, tells you your future right. And things like that. Before you answer that question, this is just me talking here, and I'm curious what you think about it. I've talked to so many spiritual masters, gurus, yogis, swamis, including channelers and near-death experiencers. And this one idea has been talked about in the Veda texts and so on, that there is no past, that there is no future, that it is all happening at the same time, that we don't technically have past lives, that past life that you're in Rome right now, you and me hanging out on a battlefield somewhere getting ready, is happening right now at the exact moment of this, because there's no time on the other side. And then when you were saying all this, I was like, well, that kind of makes sense, because if some benevolent entity, whatever that might be, or some energy brought the Torah or brought this kind of document into a world, it would know what is all going to happen.
Yeah.
And again, these are all potentials. Again, just the potentials of what will happen in the future. In other words, if things keep going in this direction, that will happen. But we do have free will, and we can keep things are moving and shaking all the time. So what are your thoughts on that, sir?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, well, first I want to just say to you, I appreciate the opportunity. This is a deep conversation. And for some people, it may be new. Mm-hmm. And I just want to acknowledge that things we're talking about, for some people, it's a very different way of thinking. And I totally mm-hmm. get that, because these aren't the things that we're taught when we're in school. And most of our parents don't, you know, they don't know about it. You don't talk about it at the breakfast table. You know, you don't get up and
well,
and
I do. Talk. I do, but that's
well, just... I do as well. So at the dinner table, but that's why we could probably be neighbors and
yes,
have a great time.
Absolutely.
Nothing else would ever get done if we were neighbors. You know that,
absolutely.
Right? Absolutely. So a couple of things here. First of all, this code does not appear to be present in any other aspect of what we call the modern Bible. It's only in the Torah, which is a standalone document that was borrowed and incorporated into during the time of Constantine, when they actually created what we call the modern biblical canon, is when they took a lot of independent documents that had been circulating for a while and tried to put them together into some kind of a coherent document. And it is believed that there was a divine inspiration that led the choices, but they were human choices. However, the Torah, I'm fascinated by this, the new translations, or the original translations of the Torah. So again, I'm I I a kid watching black and white TV in the 50s and 60s, and Charlton Heston did a movie, and it was you see him. It's called The Ten Commandments, and it's emblazoned into my brain. And I know a lot of people my age. We see Charlton Heston stumbling down from the top of Mount Sinai, and each arm he's got a giant stone tablet that has the Ten Commandments that he's just received. And a lot of people think that's the way it worked out. This is fascinating, Alex. What the translations, the original translations suggest now that the entire Torah was given to Moses as a continuous string of letters with no spaces and no punctuation that were emblazoned upon a crystalline structure that he held only in the palm of his hand. And when we find the original Ark of the Covenant, we will find that crystalline structure. It wasn't these massive tablets, you know, that were coming down. I mean, it's fun to think about that. But so what the mathematicians have done is mimic what the Torah says is the way it was received. They converted all of the information into numbers, no punctuation, no letters, into 64 rows of 4,772 characters per row, giving us the 305,000 plus characters that are in the Torah. And it appears to be a quantum map of all possibilities. Now, that doesn't make a lot of sense until we tie it into another conversation. The science now suggests the odds are greater that we are living in a simulation or a virtual reality than that we are not. Now, it may not make any difference. When I finish this, I have another interview, and I'm going to jump into my Dodge Ram pickup, and I'm going to pick up my dry cleaning. All right. Mm-hmm. So that is going to make any difference. But if we are in a simulation, it makes sense that we would have been given a map or a guide in some form as to what's possible in the simulation. So we can think of the Torah less, it's not about predicting, but it's about choice. If we do this, then these things will happen. And it's very complex, but I could see how an advanced intelligence could program that into this dynamic document, because every time we make a choice, what we're doing is we're changing our personal timeline. Mm-hmm. If you meet your high school sweetheart, as a friend of mine did, and they only date one another and stay together for 70 years. I have a friend that has done that.
Wow.
What they say is they got it right the first time. It doesn't mean that we have it wrong if we don't, but they're one of those. I think it's a very cool thing.
But if Marty McFly comes back in time and interrupts that meeting,
there you go. There you go. Well, you know, John Bon Jovi went all through his years of touring the world, and he says the same thing. He met his sweetie and they were in school, stayed with her the whole time. And in the interviews, he will say, I got it right the first time. And it brings tears to my eyes. It's just a really beautiful thing. The point is, if someone does that, then they establish their two timelines come together, and they share a timeline. If they are together 30 years and they divorce, all right, now there's a bifurcation in that timeline, and they will go on their separate ways and begin making their new choices, new people. The Torah accommodates all of that. It allows for all of that. It's the idea is just kind of a mind blower, because it is not just multi-dimensional. It is a holographic, hyper-dimensional matrix. And those are big words for, you know, that probably just don't mean a lot of things to a lot of people. But the fact that it exists in a document that appeared on Earth 3,000 years ago, and what it says to us is that we do have choice. Now, I'm just going to give an example. There was a query that was done, Atomic Holocaust of Israel. And it came up in the document, Atomic Holocaust. I don't have it in front of me, so I'm paraphrasing. Mm-hmm. And then across that, the horizontal, it was the year 2000. There could have been an atomic holocaust. And then it comes up right next to that with the words, will you change it? Will you change it? See, I get goosebumps just saying that, because wow. it means that we have choice. We have so many choices, we think it's infinite. They are probably confined in this matrix, but there's so many, we'll never reach the end of our choices. To us, it feels like infinite free will. And it's through that document. This is why Yuval Harari, if you're listening, my brother, I'm just going to, I know you probably mean well. I don't think we should change the Bible, and certainly not through AI, because we're empowering AI with our own fears and our own bias, and then amplifying that. And I think that would be a horrible mistake. He believed it would be a unifying principle because it would bring us together under one Bible, one religion. And that falls into the bigger picture of what we're seeing happening, the move towards centralization and uniformity, where everybody is the same, the lifestyle is the same, housing is the same, income is the same. This is a push that some people believe is the utopia of the future. I personally believe it's a mistake, because it limits imagination, creativity. It limits it's counter to the very nature of our humanness. Right. We just aren't wired that way. So there's a handful of people with ideas, and they're certainly entitled to those, but we didn't elect them, Alex. They're not our elected officials. And I don't think they should be, my personal opinion, I don't think that any one individual organization should have the power to determine what the life and the destiny and the fate of the human species looks like for an entire planet. That's just my one man's opinion.
I would agree with you 110%. You can't box in the human spirit. You can't box it in. It has to express itself in so many different ways. One box doesn't fit everybody. But going back to what I said before, the I Ching, it sounds a little bit like that, because I don't know a lot about, I know some things about the I Ching, the rudimentary level of I Ching. What is your feeling on that document in that tradition?
I cannot speak as authoritatively to the I Ching as I can to the Torah, because I've spent years studying the Torah. My sense, and the limited access I've had, is that the I Ching is also working with possibilities, quantum possibilities. And I don't know if it can be used in a way that gives us the same information, that gives us the outcomes. Sure. Because the I Ching, I mean, all of these things tie into the Enneagram, and, you know, all of these predictive kinds of traditions, they're all very ancient. They're very ancient, and they're all saying to us, I think what we can all gain from this is at a high level, every one of them is saying to us that we have a choice, that there are potentials and possibilities. They don't use the word quantum, but that's the word it makes sense now, because we understand a quantum possibility is an energetic potential. It has not been made manifest. If you're thinking of energy, it's like scalar energy versus vector energy. A scalar potential doesn't mean much. It doesn't have a lot of punch, because it is simply that. It is a potential. It's only when it becomes vector, when it becomes something real, that it has that potential. And I think a lot of these divination traditions had bits and pieces of that understanding, all telling us that we're not what we've been told, we're more than probably we've ever imagined, and that there is a deep potential within all of us, Alex, that we're only beginning to understand. And it all comes down to our humanness. And we're being encouraged to give our humanness away to the technology before we know what we're giving away. And I think we owe it to ourselves. I'm not saying don't embrace the technology, but we're being encouraged to have computer chips in the brain, for example. This is the new company.
Yeah, I forgot the name of it. Yeah, I know what you're saying.
I did too. I just spaced it. This is the company from... from Elon Musk has created the company to do that, or sensors under the skin, or chemicals in the blood that enhance our bodies. I want everybody, I mean, we're going on and on, we're covering a lot of ground, but I want you to think about this. The blood that's, I'm going to look right in the camera and talk to our global family, our brothers and sisters. The blood that's in your veins is the product of a chemistry that has evolved over eons of time to the perfection that it is today. A handful of people have identified certain limited characteristics they believe they can modify. The question is, do they understand how those modifications influence the eons of connectivity and the perfection? And I have to call it that because there is a perfection in our blood. Do they really understand that enough to say with certainty that this is something that we should do? And I think we owe it to ourselves to ask that, to honor the sanctity of the blood that courses through our veins and the DNA in our bodies. And we're not taught to think that way, Alex. Taught to think that way.
No, we're not, because there is the thing called ego, and that man, anytime, and if movies and literature has taught us anything, Frankenstein and so on, that when man tries to play God or source or whatever you want to call him, it doesn't technically work well, because they only see the surface. They don't see the massive depth of, if you move this part, the ripple effects, because you don't truly understand the entire. Look, anytime I go to a doctor, and I love our doctors and they do very good work, but you know, it's called a practice for a reason. They're practicing. And a lot of times you get really great doctors who kind of really understand a certain aspect of your body and really grasp it. And others have absolutely no idea. You know, I've had a problem, like a physical ailment in my leg for years, and I couldn't get it. I went to multiple doctors, couldn't figure it out. Went to one physical therapist in 20 seconds. I am not 20 seconds. It was gone. And I'm like, would you magic us? No, it's just this. They don't understand, because doctors aren't trained in that aspect. And that's the thing. It's like a scientist might want to throw a chip in your brain, but are they fully trained in understanding the entire body? Because we truly still don't even understand the body.
Exactly. You know, there was a chart that came out in 2018. It was the map of the human metabolic system. And they printed it on the textbooks, and you can bring it up on the computer. Nobody can read it because it is so complex. It's everything is connected to everything else. And it's that chart that tells us why there are no side effects. When you take an antihistamine for hay fever, it may help the hay fever. It may also make you drowsy. They say don't operate heavy machinery or drive. Some people, it makes it hard to urinate, because everything is connected. And they're not looking at it. The same thing happens with the Earth. As a geologist, we've got a White House congressionally mandated report came out June 30th, exploring the potential of spraying sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere to reflect light from the sun, keep it from reaching the Earth, so we can cool the temperature of the Earth. All right. The Earth is very similar to that metabolic system. They're talking about the atmosphere, but we don't have an atmosphere in a vacuum. We have a lithosphere. That's underneath our feet. We have a biosphere. That's all the life. We have a cryosphere. That's the ice on the planet. We have a hydrosphere. Those are the oceans. What is the effect of sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere on these? And I can tell you, it begins to kill the plankton in the hydrosphere. It impacts the biosphere. And they're not looking at all they're saying is we need to reflect the light. Can they do that? Yeah, but they're so myopic. They're saying, yeah, we reflect the light. What, and then you ask, I know scientists working on these projects, and you ask them, what are the implications in society? What are the implications in the biology? And they'll say, hey, I don't know. It's above my pay grade. You know, you need to ask somebody else. And so when we talk about replacing the Bible with an artificial intelligence, can we do it? Yes. Is it a good thing to do? What are the implications? And I don't know that anyone has thought those through. The fact they haven't thought them through when it comes to spraying in the atmosphere or chemicals in our bodies leads me to believe they probably haven't thought this through very well as well, Alex.
Exactly. And it's like those, I don't know what, and please forgive me, which what it is, but I know that there was a, let's say there was a crocodile problem somewhere and the crocodiles were out of control. Their numbers were overwhelming. And the humans were like, you know, this is just enough. Let's introduce something to take care of this. And they introduced something to take care of the crocodiles. But all of a sudden, you know, and I'm using that as an example because in the Everglades, it's exactly what happened. Pythons yeah. have been let go. And now the python is the apex predator where there was never, or at least not in thousands of years, the gators have always been the apex predator. So it's now messing with the entire ecology and the entire ecosystem of that space because no one thought, hey, what if? And I'm using, that's not because pythons were accidentally thrown in, but there are other areas where there's like a bird problem and they bring in a frog to kill something and then the bird, and then no, there's too many frogs, you know.
Sure. You know, they're doing, I live in the desert Southwest. They're doing that with the wolves. The wolves are gone. Now they're reintroducing them and it's changing what's happening in the ecosystem.
Yes.
And I know we're close to our time. I just want to say the company we couldn't think of is called Neuralink. Neuralink okay. is the FDA approved chip that now can be implanted into the human brain for wireless access to the keyboard and the hard drive of your computer. And I'm not saying it's right, wrong, good, or bad. I'm saying that there are implications because when our brain produces the neurons that it does until the last breath of our life, they're not limited at birth. We now know we're producing them throughout our lives. The catch is those neurons must be engaged in a meaningful way within about 14 days or they will atrophy and die. If we're replacing the function of those neurons with chips, then our brain begins to think that it doesn't need to produce those anymore. And we lose an aspect of our humanness in one generation. The next generation, the body says, oh, well, that was an appendage of something we used to do, but we don't need it anymore. This is how you lose a species. It's exactly how you lose a species. So I think, you know, we covered a lot of ground, Alex, and I think it's all important. These are all important things to talk about. The bottom line for me is all of them are inviting us to embrace the deep truth of who we are and what our potential is as a human. And the spirituality that comes from that is how we relate to ourselves and to one another and those deeply spiritual principles. And as we awaken those, what happens is there are values, human values that become very apparent. Values like the sovereignty of our bodies and like freedom to share ideas. I think those are values that most people can agree on. And the sanctity of life and the way that life is presented on the planet. And as those values become apparent, I think we need the framework of those values to inform us in terms of how we use these amazing technologies in our lives. Because without those values, the technologists are just going to push the boundaries as far as they can until something reels them in. So we have to make very clear what it is that we cherish as individuals, as families, as communities, societies, as nations. What are the values we cherish? Now, I don't claim to know what all of them are, but I think it's a conversation that we owe it to ourselves to have among ourselves so that, and I think it's going to come up first with AI because it's advancing so quickly. How far do we allow the AI to go? How much of ourselves will we give away to the AI and how much of our lives will we entrust to this artificial intelligence? And those are questions that we have to answer sooner than later as a society.
Gregg, as always, I could talk to you for at least another 6 or 7 hours. You are welcome back anytime. We have to do this quarterly. I think a quarterly at this point. We have to have you on the show because we have such a great time. Can you tell everybody where they can find the amazing work you're doing for the world?
Sure. Thank you, Alex. Well, my website, www.greggbraden.com, GreggBraden.com. That two G's means that I am a Gregg and not a Gregory. One G is short for Gregory, and my mom's wanted me to be a Gregg. So GreggBraden.com, and everything you need to know about where I'm going to be and what I'm going to be doing is right there, that one-stop shop.
And Gregg, do you have any parting messages for the audience about this all this amazing conversation that we've talked about?
You know, Alex, and to our community, our global community, and I consider you community, I consider you my family. These are big conversations. They're big ideas. I think it's important to talk about them. And I also think it's important to bear in mind, ultimately, it all comes down to us. We are learning about ourselves in the presence of new technologies and new ways of thinking. And it's inviting all of us to come to terms with the deep truth of who we are and what it means to be human in this world, and perhaps for the very first time, to explore the deepest potentials of that humanness. So I think it's important just to bear that in mind, Alex, as a context, to keep everything kind of in perspective, because some of these topics, it's so easy to go down the rabbit hole and just, you know, get lost in so much of what's happening here. It really comes down to us.
My friend, my brother, I appreciate you and being and the work you're doing and the champion that you are to get these ideas out there in the world. So I appreciate you, my friend. Thank you again.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey. And don't forget to subscribe.